So Jaakko Seikkula is our next presenter. Jaakko is from Finland. He is a professor in psychotherapy and a researcher devoted to challenge psychiatry from the inside through the open dialogue approach. Welcome, Jaakko.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having this possibility. First of all, I have to, of course, thank Karina and others to organizing this kind of meeting and making an initiative of the Institute. I have to say that I'm also very pleased to have Barbro Sandin here in the audience, because you really was a big hero for me in the early 80s, starting to find a new ways of working with psychotic problems. And of course, we are very grateful of the great work that you have been doing. In my presentation, I will speak from a point of view of a scientist. Nowadays, when people ask that who am I, and I have to define the work, so I think more and more myself as a scientist, because that's a field within which I want to move. Of course, it's a bit bad reputation with science and research and the academic world, but that's also a place in which we have to make some changes to happen. Bob Whitaker told here about that within the research, within science, there is many times misread the results or misinterpreted the results of the research that is done. Peter Kötze has done a tremendous work and especially opened up the way that many times the research is based on a fraud. That is even more a kind of crime, the word that he is using. And my point of view is that perhaps in an even more profound way that very much of the basic premises of science on which this treatment recommendation of treatment of excellence are based is non-valid to our field. And what I'm going to present here is to open up my way of focusing more a kind of research that is here name is a kind of naturalistic research of outcomes, processes, and try to make that available also in comparison with the golden standard of research. I many times we criticize of someone in the field to say that this research that we have been doing is not follow the golden standard of research, and that's why it would not be referred, for instance, in the reviews that they are making. But in the end, I will come actually in the conclusion that this is more valid research than these clinical trials that are most often the golden standard of research that we are doing. So what is it when we talk about naturalistic design? And I will take an example of course, the research that I have been mainly doing. Most part of my research has been focusing on that it's called open dialogue approach in many different point of views, and in the end I will focus more on the research that we have that concerns of medication. So for me, the idea of research looking from this point of view is to look at what happens in the real world and not to organize the world to make research possible. It's not a laboratory design. Thank you. Speaking with a scientific term, this kind of research emphasizes the external validity of the research. A big, big problem in the research, in the empiristic clinical trials, is that the external validity of the research is so poor that when those ideas are put into practice, the effect is lost. And doing the research in this way that I propose can take care of that big problem of the research. And it means that we do our design according to the needs that we have in developing the practices or according to specific interests, and not only follow the one way of doing the research. And of course, the idea mixed method is very much used with an idea to emphasize and take into use many kind of methods, statistical, qualitative, whatever methods of science. Because in science, there are really good methods to look at the reality that increases our understanding. In naturalistic research, we can make research of interactional therapies. This is only a term. I mean here that it's not always necessary to have a manual that we follow and make an exit analysis, but we really can look at what happened in the natural ongoing interaction between the therapist and between the clients. Perhaps for me, the way is to make first a kind of follow-up of what happens if we adopt a new ways of treatment, for instance, people who may suffer of psychotic problems. Make a follow-up and look at the outcomes in what criteria we want to do. For instance, in the studies that I have been doing, we look at how much people are employed or how much they are living on a disability allowance. Very simple way to look if they have psychotic experiences or not. And the second step is very important. Then to go into deep and look at what happens in specific situation in which you are at risk. Very simple way is the thing that we call a kind of extreme situation analysis. We take one situation that went into very well, and then we take another situation that went not so well. And then we made a comparison of those what happened, of those processes that happen. So the idea of poor and good outcome comparison is an important part. And then finally, make an integration. What does this analysis of these cases tells us about this broader picture of what we are looking here. I give only some examples, but my main focus is really on these issues of the medication. Research really has been a kind of basic idea. Actually, I could say that there would not be any open dialogue without research. It's so essential part. So that without doing research, without taking the possibility to look in a systematic way of the new practice, nothing like this ever appear, and of course nothing like this would have stayed alive. So that I try to repeat many times that it is so essential to realize that the research, without research we cannot survive with humanistic point of views of life. One of the very first studies was to look at what we call about the boundary when a family and a hospital meet when someone is hospitalized. And then we start to organize the open meetings. And for us, the naming was that we were looking at the boundary system because we really thought that within this interaction, there emerges a kind of new world that only can be participated and guided about those people who participate in the meetings. We realized, for instance, that in this meeting, there were different kind of situation. It was very different for a client who, for the first time, was on the way to the hospital and the family, compared to a situation in which there was a recurrent hospitalization when the family had a very big frustration of the situation and perhaps were demanding of the hospitalization, even if the team would already have found another way to do it. And then the third kind of situation in which you really have been living a long time in the system and in which this institution have become a main part of the social networks. And we realized that working as a team is very important because only by working with the team in this kind of admission interviews, there is access to look at the broader social network of the clients. And of course, these were the first ideas to start the focus of the idea of dialogue, because in this research, the concept of dialogue became a part of describing what happens in the situation. And a second big part that I will refer are these studies of psychosis, psychotic problem. Birgitta was already referring some of those. So we actually have three period of studies of first-time psychotic patients who come into the treatment in Western Lapland. First part, as Birgitta noted, was a kind of part of a Finnish national study. And as Birgitta noted, it was one idea to find what is the role of antipsychotic medication in the treatment of psychosis. And the Western Lapland was one of the three sites in which the idea was followed not to start the psychosis medication in the beginning, but only afterwards. The word antipsychotic medication is a bit obscure because people say that it's not antipsychotic. So perhaps it's better to speak psychosis medication. Someone speaks about neuroleptic medication and so on. And we got a very interesting outcome. It was a very big surprise in the beginning to realize that so few actually needed the medication because that was the time of the history of neurotoxic process of brain that at the time started to emerge into the field. And it was a big idea that every psychotic patient should be medicated immediately in the beginning of the treatment. But that did not happen, and then we decided that we want to have a more information and went on and having a second inclusion period for 94 to 97. And then for different reasons, Birgitta called this a multicenter study, but also for a local interest, there was done also a third period of inclusion period of the patient in which all this happened. I will come back to this study. One of the very important process of research was conducted by Professor Jukka Aaltonen, who has been a supervisor in the system for a long time. And this was a study that we conducted to be aware how is the system of treatment, what are the basic elements of it, and how is it different compared to the traditional system. A big change in the system happened somewhere at the 90s, because it was realized that there is no need of hospitalization if we meet with the family before the decision of hospitalization was done. And therefore, there was organized mobile crisis intervention teams in the way that they went homes and met with the clients, meeting with a very severe situation. And then we analyzed by looking at the patient records. We actually read some 3,000 patient records with Jukka and chose 300 who had a first-time psychotic problems in their lives and followed in the patient records 2 years' time of the treatment and made a kind of content analysis, qualitative content analysis of the treatment. And as an outcome of that analysis, we concluded that what are the basic elements of an optimal treatment in this new period of time in which we work intensively with family outside the hospital and want to be immediately there before any decisions are made. And then we came into the conclusion that are known as a kind of basic principles of open dialogue. And this is what I mean, that there would not be open dialogue without research, because this, what many people say, they are principle of something, but actually they are not principles of something, because they are outcome of a research, of a content analysis that is done in a research to realize that the optimal treatment presupposes immediate start, inclusion of the family and the rest of the social network, adopting different methods of treatment in a flexible way to adopting the unique needs of everyone, and guaranteeing the responsibility and availability of the system, and then also making across the boundaries to guarantee the psychological continuity of the system, and then in the end to tolerate in the certainty, and in this process focus more on the dialogue than aiming at finding a solution of the problem. Those were the ideas, ingredients that we thought that are very relevant as a kind of optimal treatment process in very severe crises. At the same time, we started to focus more and more about the dialogical process. By the way, this was the process in which we also thought that how could we name this system? And that was the first time we thought that perhaps this could be called as a kind of open dialogue treatment, and 1995 there was the first paper to publish about this process, about this naming of the system. We have been doing a lot of research of the dialogical qualities to understand more. My colleague Kauko Haarakangas has made his dissertation. I myself have been involved in developing a tool of looking at the dialogical processes. In dialogical processes, the most important part is to look at the response. How do we respond? And how do we, in our responses, help the process to go on and to help the people have a feeling and that they have been recognized and heard. As a one part of this process, we, for instance, realized that when there is a good outcome or poor outcome in a psychotic crisis, many very, very important things happen in the very first meetings with our clients. And this is one study that I have done myself, in which there was a comparison of 10 cases in which the outcome was a good one, as we could. Some people have returned to work and so on. And then there were 10 cases in which the outcome was a poor, that they still were dependent on the system, some of them living on a disability allowance. And then when I looked at the dialogue in the filmed sessions, we realized that there really are differences in the quality. For instance, we realized that the idea that there is a, as we call, symbolic meaning making in a very few cases in which there is not so optimal outcome. So the discussion, the dialogues were only focusing of these very concrete issues of treatment without having access of more a kind of making meaning in a symbolic way of the ideas. Sorry not to have time to go into details with this system. But then the main part of what I'm going to speak in this. So the what I've spoken here is only to say that in many, many ways I have not spoken of all the studies. The idea is to combine the research to have an information of the system for those who develop the system. And this is my idea of the naturalistic research, that we do it for ourselves. We do not do it mainly for the audience outside to make evidence that this is how powerful our system is. But it's done to ourselves to understand what are the good outcomes and especially what are the situations in which the things are not going that well, as it said. Okay, then very important part on the whole has been these three studies of psychosis, first-time psychotic patients making contact. And I will tell more detail of this during the first two periods of time, 92 to 97. We followed after of the patient for 5 years' time. And it really was the aim to increase the treatment outside the hospital in home settings, and secondly, to increase our knowledge what is the role of psychosis medication in the crisis. Again, a very important part of this naturalistic research is the one that I say here in beneath. All follow-up interviews were organized in the way that always the team, all those members who are involved in the treatment are invited into the meetings, which means that they have a feedback of their work immediately. And they do not need to wait 5 years before this is published in a scientific journal to know how did we do it. So this immediate feedback process is a part of it. It's not a disturbing factor, or it does not a kind of decline the reliability of the knowledge, but that is the idea on the whole, that we invite all the staff to be part of this system. Well, perhaps not go so much into these characteristics of the patient, but this is the description of the first question. Do we manage with this system create situation in which people are less hospitalized in this new approach? And when we made a comparison of these two periods, this green one, described the situation of those who came into the treatment during the first part of this inclusion period. It's a kind of early way before we came into the conclusion of open dialogues. And this is yellow one is the one who came later on in the treatment. And very simple. We can see that on both period of times, those who came later on in the treatment, they had a much less hospital days compared to those who came early on. So what does it mean? It means that the staff member really can learn to work in a difficult situation more at the homes of the clients to avoid hospitalization and, of course, the risk things that may appear. About as many were in hospital, about half of the clients had some contacts in the hospital, but now in the second period it was much, much shorter stay in the hospital. Then the second one was the question about the medication. What is the role of medication? And as Birgitta described, the idea was not to start the medication in the beginning, but postpone that and look if this intervention as such are helpful. And in this is a question to look at that this is a very, if someone is familiar with Strauss-Carpenter rating scale of the symptoms that is here, that you don't have any psychotic experience, and here is that you have a very severe psychotic experiences. And then when we follow that 5 years period of time, if this was related with not using or using or continuing medication, we realized that there was a slight difference in the way that those who never had used medication had a much better outcome concerning their psychotic experiences in 5 years. And those who were had used medication most probably had also still very severe psychotic experiences. In a way, this is part of it is self-evident, because the idea is to have the most serious situation in which medication is used. But of course, there is also the second part, that is to say that preventing the medication do not cause any problem for the future. So it's very, very, very good way to do it. And we looked the same in the number of relapses, and then we found a really significant difference. Those people who were on medication had significant more relapses compared to the people who were not on medication. Actually, totally contrary of the idea that was said, that the reason for using psychosis medication from the very beginning is to prevent the relapses. And here our outcomes are the opposite. That if you go into, if you are in as severe situation that medication is needed, there is also the probability of these problems coming back are higher. And again, having the treatment without going into the psychosis medication do not increase the probability of relapses. Well, this is very known outcome in which we followed, looked at the employment status, how are they doing. And then only making a comparison. These results are something that has been criticized a lot, some of them. Also in a very nasty way, there was, for instance, a group of professors in Norway who made it in very, very, ugly attack to our research, saying that this cannot be true. We have been excluding the most serious cases, and because, for instance, they said that in our research, 40% of the families do not participate into the meeting, and we report that only one of those 90 did not have family included in the way. So and then there are someone saying that this is not the golden standard of research, that you cannot do evaluation of your own practice, and these are not reliable. Making a comparison into a kind of a treatment as usual, we all also have in our system a kind of comparison to different units, but this is taken from another 5-year study that was done in Södermalm in Stockholm. And before they came into a kind of reorganizing the system, and I have taken this because there are very few long-term follow-up studies in treatment of psychosis. And then we realized that there are some very, very important differences compared to the outcomes that we have had. As you can see, so that one of the differences is the mean age of the clients. Those who came into the treatment in Stockholm, they are a bit older compared to Western Lapland. And my hypothesis, this is not any exact knowledge, is that because we know that when there is a system, when there is no access to crisis intervention, people are between 1 to 3 years psychotic before they come into the treatment. And in this crisis intervention services, perhaps that they were a bit younger is a part of the realizing that it really can shorten the duration of untreated period of time. They were hospitalized 4 times more. There was almost always in a medication. And this is, of course, the most shocking outcome. Many studies have shown that psychotic people, after 2 years or after 5 years, 60 to 70% of them are living on a disability allowance. And in our studies in Vestal-Lapland, it was only 19%. Actually, it was only 15% because we did not reach all the patients because they had moved to work in Helsinki area. So that it's even lower. This is, by the way, the idea on the whole in many research that those who are in a most severe situation, they are most often reached into the follow-up interviews, and those who have the better because they are living their life in different parts of those. So we had a good reason to repeat, and then it became possible to organize in our network, psychosis network, the study for the third time to look. And this was done in a bit minor way to collect information of the first time psychotic patients that Birgitta again told about. And we followed those in 2 years' time. What we learned was that the outcomes were very much the same. 84% returned to full employment. So that the criticism that has been said that this cannot be true, so there is no ground for that. But there were also some very interesting notions about differences. We realized that people are shorter and shorter time with their psychotic problems before they make contacts, and now it had declined into 3 weeks' time. And at the same time, we realized that the incidence of schizophrenia in that area has radically decreased. In the middle of 85, the incidence of schizophrenia patients were 33 new schizophrenia diagnoses per 100,000 inhabitants. And now, 2003-2005, it was three, or actually two, but to take a risk and say it's three. But it's one-tenth compared to the situation how it was. Huge decline. And of course, however you think about it, about what is, this is not a research of making a kind of explanation that this happens. But of course, this is a very important to start to make questions, many questions. What happened to our societies when we learned to take care of polio, tuberculosis, and those kind of illnesses? And all of a sudden, we can make a question, what about if there is no schizophrenia? And now I'm not speaking of diagnostic concepts, but on the whole of the phenomenon. Would that not be interesting issue for politicians, for instance, to think about? Yeah, and so on. There is also another point, and this is, for me, very important concern, the naturalistic design. We know, for instance, in the psychotherapy research, and this is also in medical trials, that when the practice that has been studied in empiristic trials are put into practice, 20% of the efficacy is lost. But here, there is no loss about this. Actually, this is the only study that I know in the world that has replicated the same 10 years after and having the same outcome as it was before. And of course, this is one basic for me to say that the external validity of this kind of research is higher compared to these empiristic trials. And also in the way that because we now look at the real world, we do not lose the effect even if we are applying that in a different ways. Okay, I've come into the making some conclusions about the issue. First of all, the big idea that I said in the beginning, that open dialogue is a kind of approach that has been developed in an intertwined process of research and practice. Practice informed the research in a way to take out the topics, what shall we know more about, and what should be made research about, and the research is done in a way that all the time inform the practice that people can learn about their practice and know about how it's going. And at the same time, there is organized training, and through this training, all the information that is received from the research is delivered in the way and again put into practice among the professionals. So there is a system, systemacy and practical ideas in the treatment, in making an evaluation of your own practice and having an education for the staff. In Tornio, it's put into practice in a 3 years training for all who work there. The naturalistic research design gives very valuable information about the local practice. And now this is, of course, very, very challenging because in this kind of situation, we cannot do a kind of conclusions, a linear or causal explanation that we can generalize to the all, for instance, Finland or population. We can make a conclusion that in this local context, when this way of working was put into practice, the outcomes are like this. We can make a conclusion that working like this, it's possible to decline the role of a psychosis medication and the outcome seems to become better. But we cannot claim that declining the role, taking the medication away would automatically lead into a better outcome, because it's very much related in this local, what happened in this local context. I referred already to this idea of this external validity, who form, actually for me this is the basic criteria of research. I know that in empiristic trials this is something that is discussed in the sub-sentences. Well, the external validity is not that high, but actually that's not so important, you see, because they want to follow the golden standard of research. First of all, this was a kind of a non-medication group of patients from the very on, first on of the treatment. I don't know any other research in which this question of psychosis medication has been researched in which the people do not start the medication. Because all the studies that I know are run in the way that first everyone is medicated and then the randomized group is stopped the medication. It's very, very unfair situation for those who are not medicated because they are used to the medication and before that. And in my knowledge, I hope that I'm wrong, but this is the only study in which there is a group of people who have not been medicated in the outset and then followed what happened with them. Of course, we cannot do a kind of group comparison because the groups are different, but perhaps that is not even so important issue. And then the idea is that it's a selective use of medication. Actually, this medication research, in my mind, it's very, very strange way to do research. That you make a research in which you give the same amount of medication for people, whatever other problems. I'm not a medical doctor myself, but I would imagine that no medical doctor is doing that in his consultation. It's not the case that you are a doctor, I give you 10 milligram this because I also gave to the previous patient, the one. It's not the case. It's a very strange idea of the research. And in my mind, these placebo trials as such are non-valid way of making conclusions in the effect of medication. And then they are making this group comparison that easily can also find in a very short follow-up period is usually 6 to 8 weeks, and then with a very slight group mean differences, you make a conclusion of the entire people who are here. And again, it's a very use of power instead of being doing a serious science about it. And then the third point is that we made a replication about the same 10 years after, because it's possible, because the system of treatment is a continuous, and it's possible to do, and finding the very same kind of outcomes and could verify that this is the situation following this idea. There are, of course, good points to be critical of it. For instance, we cannot guarantee the reliability of the methods in the same way that we can guarantee in the we cannot take care of the of some of the factors that we cannot make control, which means that we cannot do explanations. And of course, these are not explanation studies, but it's a more a kind of descriptive study of what happens if we put this kind of system into work. Okay, this is the end, only to repeat this, what Birgitta already was saying, that it's very interesting because now we are on the way by Tommy Barrestrom, is the psychologist who is mainly responsible of looking 20 years after some of them, 25 years after some of them, perhaps 15 years after, how are they having in their lives, both in the kind of Finnish national register, but also in the interviews of their life stories. But again, I suppose that this is a very relevant for the system, again, to have the information about what are the very long-term outcomes in this kind of system. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Jaakko. So now we have a coffee break and we all be back here 4:20. Thank you.